Who's president of the United States? Anybody know? Know his name? Justin? Yes? What's his name? Yes, Barack Obama. Are there two presidents or only one? There's one. How many ride the school bus to school? Is there one bus driver or two? There's one. I can imagine my bus driver, Becky, coming to school and having a full-grown man with a beard on her lap trying to help her drive the bus. That doesn't make any sense. There can only be one. And Jesus tells us, the God of our life, there can only be one. One Lord. That's it. Earlier this week, I was going through something that could really hurt me in a number of different ways, areas of my life, and I went to my friend who's a teacher at my school, and we were sharing with each other. He was sharing some things that he's been going through with his family and wife and some financials, and we shared with each other, and I was telling him how God's been dealing with me through that. Is I was telling God, Lord, I'm struggling. Lord, I'm fearful. Lord, in a way, I was worried. I was this, I was that, and God says, I know who you are, know who I am. And it changed my whole outlook of what was going on, and my friend and I were sharing with each other and ministering to each other through that word. It's not who we are, it's who he is. Children, if you guys will stand up with me. Let me squeeze in over here. Stand up and come on in. Matthew chapter 19, it has Jesus, and Jesus is hanging out with some children. And people were hating on him for it. And he says, bring them up here. I'm going to lay hands on them and pray for them. Don't turn them away from me. The kingdom of God belongs to them. There's something special about being a child. My boss, during our school Christmas party, was ministering to the school staff, and he said, when I got saved, it was like I really felt like I was a new being, like I was a little kid again. And I could relate to that, because he was saying, when I was a little kid, it was before the world put the weight on my shoulders, before the world got me into things, before the world tried to pull me away from my original true purpose that I had whenever I was born. So we're gonna do just like that scene with Jesus. Kids, I want you guys to lay your hands on somebody. Just touch somebody on their shoulder. We're gonna pray. Alright? We got a lot of stuff that's going on, but it's not about who you are, it's about who he is. He is a God that is fully involved in who you are and what you're doing and your purpose. Proverbs chapter 19. It says, we have a lot of plans, but God's purpose prevails. Let's pray and let's love on one another. Children, I don't worry about you, but it's our job to love you, develop you, discipline you, raise you up. I don't worry about you, but I love you. Let's pray for our kids. Our Father, our Lord, our Savior. You're a wonderful and almighty lover, healer. You're full of intervention in our lives. You are involved. You are a conqueror. You are powerful. And God, we've come before you in many different ways and with many different things. And the only thing that really matters is who you are and the purpose that you're developing and fulfilling in this place today. Lord, we love you. And we don't need to worry. And it goes beyond just being positive and being optimistic. But Lord, we're hopeful because we trust in you. Lord, be with our kids. Be with them through pain. Be with them through trials. And that they know always, you are God. You are Lord. And you got it all taken care of. Despite all of our plans, your purpose prevails. Lord, be with our teachers, our parents, our families, as we develop these children that you have called unto you to lay hands on and pray for because you're close to them. You understand them, and they understand you. There's something so special there. Lord, we love you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you have a Bible, I want you to grab it and turn to Matthew chapter 11. Probably should inform you that what's on the front of your bulletin is our series on the Ten Commandments, but we're going to make a departure from that this morning. I feel like the Lord has laid on my heart some other things that we need to be encouraged about, to talk about. So if you have your Bible, turn to Matthew chapter 11. Don't think it's a secret that our church and a family in our church has been touched by tragedy this week. And I really feel like the Lord is taking us a little different direction this morning. So we'll get back to the Ten Commandments in a couple of weeks. But for this morning, if you have that Bible, just turn to Matthew chapter 11. Let me ask you this question before we get into it. Has anyone in this sanctuary, anyone, by the uplifted hand, ever been in a time of doubt? Look around. Just keep it up for a minute. Look around. Okay? We don't doubt Him as far as He's God. We don't doubt His existence. We don't doubt His love for us. We don't doubt the great things that He does. We don't doubt that His name's above every other name. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about that we just struggle sometimes with understanding what He's doing. He's still God. He's a good God. But sometimes we struggle with just understanding. What's He doing right now? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Sometimes you just get to that point in life where you think, okay, God, you got to help me with this. You got to show me something. And if you're just not sure what that next step is, because it doesn't seem to make sense to you, I would just encourage you to open up your heart, open up your mind, because in those moments of doubt, when we're not sure, if we misstep, listen carefully what I'm saying, when we misstep, we will become very fatigued, we will become very exhausted, and we will become a target for the enemy. The enemy is a thief. He has come to kill, steal, and destroy. Jesus came to give us life. And even in those moments when we doubt, even in those moments when we're not sure what's going on, we need to be so sure about who He is. So I got a very simple message, very simply titled, When in Doubt. When in Doubt. And there are some great champions in the Bible who went through their times of doubt. And this morning I want to talk about one in particular, and his name was John the Baptist. We're going to take a look at him this morning because I really felt like the Lord wanted some time to do some ministry to some folks this morning. Now, I hope that you will not be so tunnel visioned as to think this is just about the Schneider family. I don't want you to get tunnel vision to think that this is just about the tragedy that we've gone through, because some of you are going through some tough stuff in life right now that you don't have any idea what God's doing. And you've entered into a place, a very dangerous place of doubt. And you're wondering, what do I need to do about this doubt? And so we need to hear from the Word of God this morning and from the Lord what we do in these times. And I believe that God has this wonderful, wonderful Word for somebody this morning, for us this morning. I believe He wants to do a work through that Word. So if you have your Bible, Matthew chapter 11, we're going to read several verses. We're going to start at verse 1. If you don't have a Bible, the verses will be on the screen. Here's what verse 1 says. After Jesus had finished instructing His 12 disciples, He went on from there to teach and to preach in the towns of Galilee. When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him. John the Baptist in prison heard what Christ was doing. He sent his disciples to see what Jesus was doing. And he sent his disciples to ask this question. Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else? Listen carefully. He's in prison. He's in prison for proclaiming the name of Jesus. That's why he's there. He's in prison because he was preaching about Jesus. And now John the Baptist doubts. And he wonders. And I need us to spend some time exploring about what we should do when we're in doubt. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that you're a God in heaven that's not far removed from our circumstances. You're a good, good God. I thank you that you're so involved in our lives that you have a divine plan for our lives, and you are trying to orchestrate that plan even when we resist in our doubt. And so I pray this morning that you'll help us, that you'll just give us a teachable spirit, that you'll open us up to hear from you this morning what it is that we need to do when these seasons hit us. So help us this morning. I pray that in Christ's name. Amen. His name was Charles Blondine. He was known as the Great Blondine, and to this day, he's known as the greatest high wire walker ever. He lived in the 1800s. The thing that he did the most often that he was so well known for was ringing someone's phone. It sounds like someone gurgling water. Wow. The thing that the Great Blondine was so well known for was walking across Niagara Falls. Having a wire across Niagara Falls, 11,000 feet he had to go, 160 feet above the falls. He did it several times. He did it a lot of different ways. Sometimes he walked it just like you see the picture. Sometimes he walked it on stilts. Sometimes he put a bag around his legs and walked across in the bag. Sometimes he walked across with a man on his shoulders. Sometimes he walked across blindfolded. One time it's reported that he walked across halfway, set down the wire, fixed himself an omelet, ate it, got up and finished the walk. Then there was this one time when he got a wheelbarrow. And he started on one side with the wheelbarrow and he walked across all 11,000 feet. And then he turned around and he walked all the way back with the wheelbarrow. And when he got back to this side, he yells down to the crowd, "Do you think that I could take somebody across this wire with someone in the wheelbarrow?" And they were all like, "Yes, you're the Great Blondine. You can do anything." And then he yelled back down, "Okay, who's first?" And nobody answered. It got quiet. It got very, very, very quiet once he put that out there. And here's the takeaway. I'm going to give you the takeaway so early in this sermon. Here's simply this. It's amazing how fast our faith can turn to doubt. It's amazing how fast our faith can turn to doubt. It's one thing to be a person in the crowd of doubt, but it's another thing to be a person that says, "I will get in that wheelbarrow because I think you can do it, because I trust you, because I hope in you." And this is where John the Baptist finds himself in prison for proclaiming the name of Jesus. He finds himself at a wheelbarrow moment. He finds himself at that moment where he's got to decide, am I just going to be in the crowd of doubters, or am I going to get in the wheelbarrow? He's wondering, why is God working the way he's working? Why is Jesus doing the things that he's doing? He doesn't understand why Jesus is operating the way that he's operating. And some of us find ourselves there. Some of us find ourselves in that very spot. We just can't seem to figure out, how is it that God is functioning right now? It doesn't make any sense to me. We find ourselves sort of in that crowd of doubters that's been asked if we want to get in the wheelbarrow. John the Baptist said he was proclaiming the name of Jesus. He was a man of tremendous faith. He had done some great things, a great work for the Lord. In fact, when we look at the life of John the Baptist, even in his birth announcement, it was told that he was going to do some great things. I don't know if you remember this, but if you'll give me some liberty to go back to Luke chapter 1 for just a minute. Zechariah was John the Baptist's father. He was a priest in the temple. And they had prayed for a child, him and Elizabeth, but they were not able to have children. And Elizabeth was getting a little bit older, and Zechariah was getting a little bit more concerned that they would not have children. And one day while he was praying in the temple, God showed him something and announced to him that they would have a baby boy. And that Elizabeth would conceive. Now, I don't know about you. Anybody else in the sanctuary this morning, did you have an angel show up to announce to your parents that you was coming? Anybody? I know I didn't. I was Jonathan. But yeah, wait a minute. I'm going to ask you. You're lying in church. Mom and Dad sitting right there. You see what you've raised here. John the Baptist did. And this is what the angel told Zechariah. Luke chapter 1, verses 14 through 17. He, John the Baptist, will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's going to do some great things. This is announced before he's even born. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. I mean, think about that. You talk about being born with a silver spoon in your mouth. You've already been proclaimed that you're going to do great things. You're going to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit even from birth. You're anointed to do some great things. And then the angel goes on to say, many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah. I mean, think about this for just a moment. This is the announcement of his birth, that he's going to be like the prophet Elijah. He's going to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, and to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. I mean, this guy's going to be great. This guy's going to have it all together. They're proclaiming this even before he's conceived. This is what the angel said, filled with the Holy Spirit, doing great things. Many people are going to turn back to God because of John the Baptist. That was his birth announcement. Now, my birth announcement didn't go that way. Let me tell you how my birth announcement went. The doctor walked into my mom and dad, said, you got a boy, he's a Wagner, he's got good lungs and a square head. In other words, he's going to be loud-mouthed and he's going to be hard-headed. That was my birth announcement. It wasn't anything like this guy, nothing like John the Baptist. We knew from birth what he was going to do because that's what was announced. When we begin to look at the ministry of John the Baptist, we read the Gospels, how people flocked to hear him. How he proclaimed the name of the Lord, how he did great things, how he did all these things that were announced, how he prepared the hearts of the people for the coming Messiah. The Bible talks all about it. He did great work. This is the guy you would never think would doubt God. This is the guy that would never get to a point where he began to question things about what's going on. But then the authorities arrested him and put him in prison. And suddenly here he is in prison. And while he's there, he continues to keep a finger on the pulse of Jesus' ministry, and he hears about all the reports that Jesus is doing. And he's sitting in this prison cell, and John's thinking, like many of the Jews of that time, wait a minute, Jesus was supposed to come not just to be a savior of our souls, but he was supposed to release us from this bondage of the Romans. John believed that with the other Jewish people at the time. He was there to overthrow Rome, but yet nothing he was doing was giving any kind of indication that he was going to do that. John's watching from prison, and it's not going the way John thought it was supposed to go. Jesus hasn't even gone to Rome to try to do some maneuvering towards seeing Jerusalem set free. He never went to Jerusalem and opposed the Roman rule. And John's sitting there, and he's beginning to wonder, maybe I got the wrong guy here. Maybe I've been proclaiming the name of the wrong guy here. I don't understand what's going on. And you go back to chapter 11 of Matthew and you read verse 2 and it says, when John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask, are you the one who was to come or should we expect someone else? And so here's the first thing I would tell us when we come to these times when we doubt. Here's the first thing we should do. We should do what John the Baptist did. We should ask. We should ask. We should ask the question. When in doubt, we should ask. John the Baptist sent his guys right to the horse's mouth. He sent his guys to Jesus. And those guys went to Jesus and said, we're from John the Baptist and we want to know, are you the guy? Are you him or should we look for somebody else? And I think what you and I need to learn from that is that Jesus, the Son, God the Father, he's okay with us asking the questions. I think for some of us that grew up in church and we've been told our whole life that we're not allowed to ask those questions. And then we just become frustrated. And we just become targets for the enemy because we have this all pent up inside of us. In reality, what we should do when we doubt, the first thing we should do is ask. The first thing we should do is go and just spill ourselves to him. Empty ourselves of those feelings. Because here's what happens if we don't. If we don't vent those feelings, if we don't ask those questions, they become the things that destroy us. They become the things that set us up for deception. They become the things that the enemy uses. But what we need to understand this morning is that Jesus is okay with us asking the question. He doesn't mind us asking. And John sends these messengers and says, what are you doing? Are you the guy or not? Are you the person that we've been talking about and looking for? So he asks the question. Think about it. Even Jesus Christ himself asks the question. He's hanging on the cross. He's dying for our sins. Yet we can read in Matthew chapter 27, verse 46, that even Jesus himself said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He asked the question. God, what are you doing? God, where are you? And sometimes in the midst of things that we don't understand, there are some tough questions that we would like to ask. And I'm saying to us this morning, ask. Ask. And I'm not just talking about certain circumstances. I'm talking about all circumstances. Some of you are struggling in your relationships, in your home. Some of you are struggling with jobs. Some of you are struggling with finances. And you're getting to a point where you just don't understand what's going on. And I'm just imploring you to ask. Just ask the question. One of my favorite psalms is the 42nd Psalm. We don't really know if David wrote it or not. I've preached many sermons around this particular one. But we do know this. That it was written by someone who was being pursued by an enemy. They were being pursued by an enemy. And if you look at verse 3 of chapter 42, listen to what it says. My tears have been my food day and night. While men say to me all day long, where's your God? Where's your God? See, maybe some of us, we've been crying ourselves to sleep at night. Maybe we're asking, where are you, God? Where are you? What is this? Verse 9 goes on to say, I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by my enemy? Whoever it was that wrote the 42nd Psalm, they were asking the tough questions. And what Jesus wants us to do in these times of doubt is he wants us to empty our hearts. He wants us to come to him and ask the question. And the reason that he wants us to do that is so that stuff doesn't eat us alive. And we need to understand that he's not upset about that. He doesn't get upset when we ask the question. You got one of Jesus' disciples who people keep in freeze frame living, and we know him as Doubting Thomas because one time in his life, he doubted. All the things that he probably did with Jesus, all that 3.5 years of ministry, seeing what Jesus was doing, we only remember one thing that he did. And that was he said, I'm not going to believe that's Jesus until I put my finger in his nail print and my hand in his side. And then you read on, when Jesus finally comes to him, Jesus says, get away from me, fool. You didn't believe? No. Stay away. No, that's not what he said. What did he say? Come here. It's okay to ask the questions. He's not upset about us asking the question. He wants us to empty our hearts. Christ himself said, ask and it'll be answered unto you. Knock and it'll be opened. Seek and you'll find it. So keep asking. Keep pouring your heart out to him. Keep emptying your soul. Now listen, we may not hear what we want to hear. We may not hear what we think we're going to hear. But I can promise you, you'll hear something. Pour your heart out to him. Keep asking. Keep going to the Lord. So the first thing I would encourage us all to do in those times of doubt is just ask. But then there's a second thing that's even more challenging for us, and that is for us to remember. Remember what Christ has already done for us. Because it's so easy for us to quickly forget that. It's so easy for us to quickly forget the good things. But what we need to do is remember how God showed up in those other times. Remember how God didn't just leave us hanging. We need to remember that he's done some good things. And after the messengers from John the Baptist go to Jesus and say, are you the guy? Here's what Jesus' response is. Look at verse 4 and 5. You go back and report to John what you hear and what you see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Now listen, that list is not just some arbitrary, off-the-cuff list that Jesus decided to come up with. I don't know if you'll agree with me on this or not. In my understanding of Scripture and my understanding of Old Testament prophecy, John the Baptist was probably the last Old Testament prophet. And as an Old Testament prophet, he understood the prophecies of the coming Messiah. And he probably especially knew about the prophecies that Isaiah gave about the coming Messiah. And you and I have to understand this morning that what Jesus is really saying to John the Baptist, if I can just put it in our daily vernacular, he's saying, remember, John, remember what the prophets have said about the Messiah and what he would do. Because they are identification markers of who the Messiah is. John, you've seen these things, you've heard these things, and these things testify of me. And John would begin to sit in that prison cell, I'm sure, and remember what he had seen and what he had heard and what he had studied about what the Messiah is doing. As a matter of fact, if you just give me just a minute, Isaiah the prophet literally says the same thing that Jesus said to John the Baptist. In Isaiah 29:11, he said of the Messiah that he would see the blind and the deaf healed. In Isaiah 35:6, he said about the Messiah that the lame would walk. In Isaiah 26:19, when the Messiah came, he said the dead would be raised. And in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1, it said that when the Messiah came, the good news would be preached. It's almost identical to what Jesus said to John the Baptist. And I'm sure it's because John the Baptist knew those writings. And he knew this is the Messiah. Because he asked a question. Jesus said, remember. Remember these things that I've done. Remember what you've seen. Remember what you've heard. And when we come to those places where we don't understand and we don't comprehend and we begin to doubt and we begin to wonder, it's at that moment what we have to do is we begin to remember what he has done for us. What we got to do is remember when he's came through for us. I wonder this morning, just by the show of hands, if anybody in this sanctuary can remember a specific time when God came through for you. When God came through for you. Look around. Keep those hands up for just a moment. Look around. You know what that is? That's a monument. That's a monument to the good things of God, of what he's done for us. And when we get into those seasons of doubt, what we've got to do and what Jesus told John the Baptist to do is we've got to remember that. It's not a secret. I've said before that two of the greatest hurts of my life came at the hands of a church. It wasn't the same church. It was two different churches. I mean, hurt me once, shame on me. Hurt me twice, shame on you. So two different churches. And if I responded just the way that normal people would have responded, I wouldn't come back to church. Church would be the last place I'd want to go to. But then I remember. I remember what he's done for me. I remember how he's been good to me. And I remember that just because it doesn't look the way I think it should look doesn't mean that's not the way it's supposed to look. We've got to understand that just because we don't see it the way we want to see it, that doesn't mean God's wrong. We've got to get in the wheelbarrow. We've got to trust God. We got to believe that he can do what we know he can do. And if we can remember that God has done good, then guess what? He can do it again. He can do it again. And again, and again, and again, God will show up. He will show up. Again, it may not be the way we think it ought to be. It may not look like the way we thought it was going to look, but he shows up. When in doubt, we've got to ask the questions and we've got to remember. And we've got to depend on God to see us through those times, remembering what he's done for us. And so before I give you the third point, I do want to do something specific. Tracy, I didn't ask you if I could do this, but I want you to stand up. It's obvious that, you know, it's a tragic thing that Scotty is gone. But there is another pressing issue in the Schneider home, and it deals with Landon. I'm not going to go into all the details with you other than to say we need a miracle from God to see Landon move through this and to be able to get through this. And David Ashworth, thank you.
And
what you did. Landon's a sweet, sweet boy.
Amen.
But we need a miracle. So I want people that believe in the miracle working power of God just to gather around Tracy for just a prayer. And we're going to pray for their family, but we want to pray for Landon and for the situation with Landon, that God will give us favor in that situation. Dear Heavenly Father, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we just bow before you, thanking you that you're a God that will see us through. Thanking you that you're the God that we can hope in and that we can trust in and that our faith is in. And I just thank you, God, for wrapping your arms of love and strength and peace around this family in such a desperate time, in such a tragic time. But God, this morning we come to you and we just ask you to let your favor be seen in this situation with Landon, that you would just allow your favor to be upon every ruling and every legal issue that comes about. We just ask you, Lord God, to let Tracy and Ryan and all of that family just see once again the hand of God move. Let them remember what you've already done so that they can grab hold of that to believe you for what will be. And God, I pray that you just show up in every circumstance, in every situation, that you just show up and that you just allow them to sense and know that the miracle working power of the Almighty God once again to be released in their family. So God, you do that, and we know that we will praise you and honor you and glorify you for the answer to prayer, because it is in Christ's name that we're asking this to be done. Amen, 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 amen. Amen. If you could find your way back to your seat for just a few more minutes, I'll finish up. But let me just tell you while you're going that you know, Scotty had custody of Landon, and we have an issue at hand that needs a miraculous intervention of the Almighty God. Tracy, you need to know you and Ryan are not the only two that are bothered by that. We have people in this congregation that have lost sleep over it, wanting God's favor. So just know that they're with you on that, okay? So when we get into these seasons of doubt, what do? We've got to ask the question and we've got to remember what God has already done. But here's the biggest thing that I need us to understand this morning. And that is the third thing that I'm going to share with you. That when we get to those times of doubt, we ask and we remember, but we have to trust. We have to trust. We have to find a way to trust God. We have to find a way to get in the wheelbarrow and move across the wire. We have to find a way to trust that God knows what he's doing. And it's interesting, and what Christ makes interesting is what he says in verse 6. After he's listed all those things that the prophet said of the Messiah, verse 6, he says, take this back to John and say this: blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me. Now, it's going to take a minute to unpack this, so just be patient with me. The word blessed there is such a misused word in Christianity today. In this particular context, what it means is that a blessed person is the person where God is active in their life, orchestrating their life towards a divine purpose or a divine plan. If you're a blessed person, in the context of where this is at and the wording that's used, it simply means that God is active in your life, orchestrating the events of your life, leading to a divine purpose. Here's our problem. Here's what we struggle with. It is when we don't like the way God is orchestrating events that leads us to the divine purpose, we decide to orchestrate our own events that leads to our own purpose. And that leads us to trouble. That leads us to deception. That leads us to destruction. And he said, you tell John, blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me. In other words, blessed is the man who continually allows God to actively orchestrate the events of your life that leads you to this divine purpose. And he says, John, you're that blessed man. You're a blessed person because God is actively orchestrating things in your life, even though it doesn't look like what you thought it was going to look like. I can imagine that John the Baptist thought he was going to ride on a horse next to Christ as he conquered Rome. I can see that in John's mind. John was a Jew. The Jewish people thought that's what was going to happen. And while John also knew of the plan of salvation and what Jesus was going to have to do and the healings that was going to happen, he just believed with the rest of that Jewish population that this is what was going to happen. And so Jesus sends the message and says, blessed is the man who doesn't fall away on my account. Well, what does this thing fall away mean? It really is something that we need to take heed of. To fall away in the context of this passage means to be offended. Blessed is the man who does not get offended. Blessed is the person who says, I don't understand this. I don't understand this. This makes no sense to me. But I'm not going to be offended about it. I'm going to trust God that he knows what he's doing even when it doesn't make sense to me. Blessed is the person who's in the midst of a trying time. You may not understand it, but you're not going to be offended by it because God will always hold true to the plan that's active in your life that he's orchestrating that leads you to a divine purpose. See, here's the problem with false conversions. I said it. People who say, I believe in Jesus, but you've really never become a convert. Because the person who never really becomes a convert really never turns everything over to God. And they're double-minded, which makes them unstable in all of their ways. The true convert says, I believe in God, I believe in Jesus, that he died for my sins, and I'm going to be converted, I'm going to change, and I'm going to give him all that there is, the first commandment, no other God before him. He's it. Here's the problem. When things don't look the way I think they should look, there's something wrong with God. And I'm offended at that. I've heard some of the, I'm just going to call them what they are, is it okay? I've heard some of the lamest excuses for people who've decided to give up on church, give up on God. Some of the lamest excuses. Oh, they're real to the person. They think it's a legitimate reason, but it's not. Because if I've come to a point where I'm truly converted and I've given everything over to God, then even when things don't go the way that I thought they were supposed to go, I still trust in him. I still believe he's a good God. I still believe he's active in my life, orchestrating a plan towards a divine purpose. But see, if we're not truly converted, we find ourselves being pulled back to Egypt all the time. The pull of the world that says, listen, you don't need all that. You got credit cards. You got consolidation loans. You got Facebook. You got everything you need. You just do what you want to do. That's where we get in trouble. That's when the trouble starts. I hope you're getting what I'm saying here. Because I believe this morning, right now, is a wheelbarrow moment for some of us. I believe it's a wheelbarrow moment. When we're either going to trust God, or we're going to thumb our nose and we're going to be counted as one of those that fell away because we were offended, because it didn't turn out the way we thought it should turn out. It's a tough statement. It's a tough statement that went back to John. It's a tough statement here this morning. You know what John wanted to hear was what we wanted to hear. John sends his messengers to Jesus. They say, are you the guy or are we supposed to be looking for somebody else? Because John the Baptist is sitting in prison right now. And within the half hour, Jesus busts on the scene. And there's a jailbreak and John gets set free. Didn't happen. Jesus never said, John, I'm going to come get you out of there. Even in the middle of his doubt, this was a guy that was anointed before he was born to proclaim the name of the Messiah, to talk about Jesus. And here he is in prison, and he's getting to this point where he's kind of depressed, and he's starting to doubt. And Jesus didn't say, listen, I'm coming to get you out of there. He didn't say that. We want him to say that. We want there to be more verses to this chapter than there are, but there's not. What Jesus said is, you may not like the way it's working. You may not like what you see. There's a possibility that you could even be offended that I haven't gotten you out of there. But I've got a question for you, John. And I think it's the same question that Jesus is asking us this morning. Are you still going to trust me? It don't look right. It don't feel right. But am I going to trust God? Some of you aren't old enough to remember the song, but I love the lyric that says, I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. And there are times we just have to put our hand in His hand and just keep walking. Even when it doesn't make sense. Even when you don't understand what's going on. John, you're in prison. You don't like it. I'm not coming to get you out. But are you going to get in the wheelbarrow? Are you going to trust me? See, that's the place that a lot of us get to. I don't understand what He's doing. But all I know is that He knows what He's doing. And that's all I need to know. I don't need to know anything else. See, that was the problem from the beginning. Linda, you should probably come. I need to land this thing. That was the problem from the beginning. What did the serpent say to Adam and Eve? Oh, you're not going to die. If you eat that apple, you're going to become like God. And they say, ooh, well, that sounds good. Give me the apple. And we've been biting the apple ever since. Because we want to know everything. We want to figure it all out. When the psalmist said in 46:10, just be still. Be still and know that I'm God. He didn't say be still and know everything. He didn't say be still and figure it all out. He didn't say be still. I mean, I've been around Tracy the last 24 hours for several hours. And some of the people that think they're coming and offering comfort to that family, I wanted to jackslap them. I'm sorry. Because that's not what they're doing. All they're just poking for info and just wanting to know this one. They don't. I know Ryan. Me and Ryan had to take a walk to the river the other day. Get him away from some folks. Listen, it may not look the way we think it's supposed to look, but God is still God. God still says, I know what I'm doing. And because of that, I'm going to trust Him. I'm going to believe in Him. Even when I don't like it, when it doesn't feel right, I've got to trust Him. And I found out the hard way what happens when you don't trust Him. I found out the hard way when I don't trust Him and I decide to do things the way I think they should be done. I don't have to understand what He's doing. You don't have to understand what He's doing. You just have to know Him. All I have to know is that He understands what He's doing and that I'm going to trust Him. Blessed is the person that does not get offended by God because of how God's working and walks away from Him instead of getting in the wheelbarrow and trusting God to get you where He has divinely orchestrated your life to be. And say, I can trust Jesus especially because of what happens next before we pray. Jesus makes that statement, the messengers turn, they go back to John. And then Jesus turns to the crowd that He was with when the messengers came. He turns back to this crowd. You know what He does? He affirms John's ministry. He turns to that crowd and He says, this guy's great. The guy who just sent messengers to ask if this was really the Messiah. The guy that doubted Him. And Jesus says, it's a great, great guy. He's done some cool stuff. I mean, when I doubt and I come with those tough questions and I lay those onto Him and I find myself in this place, He doesn't throw me under the bus. He doesn't kick me to the curb. Now, I don't know about you, but that's kind of exciting to me. Here's what Jesus said about John in chapter 11, verse 11. I'll tell you the truth. Among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Was this not the guy that just doubted? Was this not the guy that sent these messengers to say, are you the one or should we be looking for somebody else? Because things are not going the way I thought they were supposed to go. And Jesus says, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. And here's the great promise to us. Yet he who is the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I'm great. That's right. You should look at your neighbor and say, God thinks I'm great. Go ahead and tell them. God thinks I'm great. You need to look at the other neighbor and say, yeah, but he thinks I'm greater. Even in those times when it doesn't look like it's supposed to look, we trust him, we remember the things he's done for us, we ask the questions, and Jesus still thinks we're great. Listen, wouldn't it be nice if we were around people who felt that way? That even in those times when you weren't real sure what's going on, they just said, you're great, don't worry about it, you're great. I wish we'd start greeting each other that way. Oh, Matthew, you're great. The way he nodded an affirmation, yeah, I know. He said, this guy's great. And I know that I can trust him. Because from the days of John the Baptist, verse 12, until now, kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and the forceful men lay hold of it. That doesn't necessarily mean that a bunch of military guys are out there fighting a fight. Although, obviously in Christianity, that has been the case. In Judaism, that has been the case. What this means is that there's a bunch of people that are really, really set in advancing the kingdom. You know how? Ask the questions, remember what he's done, trust him. When we do that, we advance the kingdom. When we can stand, even in the times of trial and tragedy, and even in times of temptation, even in times when you're going through financial difficulty, when we can stand, ask the questions, remember what he's done, and trust him, that advances the kingdom because other people see that. And the best advertisement that Jesus has on this planet, it's you. It's you. And he says, listen, in those moments, in those times, and they're going to happen when doubt sets in, do those three things. Ask. Remember what he's already done. He'll show up again. And then just trust him. Because listen, I've sat at the bedside of infants and elderly people that have asked me, why is this happening? And I'm just telling you, as a pastor of a church, maybe other pastors won't admit this, but I'll just tell you, I don't know. I sat with Christy two weeks ago on a Friday night, Cabo Huntington, about midnight, waiting for everybody to get out of the room. And I just told her, I said, Christy, I know you want to know why this is happening, but I don't know. But I do know who does know. Hello? Listen, I know who does know. So let's just trust him. Let's just put our hope in him. Let's put our faith in him. And then let him orchestrate our life according to the divine plan that he has for us. Things happen in life. Things that just don't make sense. Some things that are of our own choice even. Either your relationship and your family. Other things that we decide to do that are not of God. But that does not change who God is. He's God. And we got to trust him. Stand with me. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning for your awesomeness. I thank you this morning that you're a God that's in heaven that loves us and cares about us. You're a God that has provided a way for us to come to you and ask the questions, that you're a God that we can remember things that you've done for us and allow that remembrance then to encourage us and strengthen us. And I pray, Lord God, this morning that somehow, some way, through something that was said, that we would be encouraged. Through something that was said, that we would understand that we can trust you. That even in the most tragic of times, when we're grieving, we can trust you. Because while we cannot dictate the future, you hold it in your hand. And because of that, we just need to get in the wheelbarrow. Just let you take us where it is that you want us to go. So help us this morning, I pray in Christ's name. Keep your heads bowed for just a moment. If you're here this morning and you're not in a right relationship with Jesus Christ, your life will never reach the potential that God has planned for it, because you are not currently being orchestrated by God to reach that divine plan that he has for your life. The devil has come to kill, steal, and destroy, and he's really good at it. But Jesus came that we might have life and have it to its fullest. The only way we can have the fullest life is to know that our life is being divinely orchestrated by the Almighty towards a divine plan. And so if you're here this morning, you're not in a right relationship with Him. You can be. He's provided a way. If we can confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Christ is Lord and that God raised Him from the dead, we can be saved. And so I would call on you this morning, if you're not in that right relationship, that you would trust Him to save you and to keep you from the consequences of that sin. And so this morning, you're not in the right relationship, I'd love to pray with you. So I'm going to ask the praise team to sing this chorus through a couple times. And as they sing, all you need to do, just step out from where you're at and come and let me pray with you. Would you do it right now? About some building things going on, but before we do that, let me just say to you, don't let the enemy convince you that God somehow has a problem with you when you doubt. That's just not right, because there's plenty of biblical principle that shows us that great Bible characters, heroes of the Bible, doubted. And so what we've got to do, though, is we've got to ask, we've got to remember, and we've got to trust. Now, if you're like me, and you need one of those mnemonic devices to remember that, it's the word art, okay? Art. Ask, remember, trust. So when you go home this afternoon and you're eating your lunch and you say, can't remember what the things that I was supposed to do, somebody else at the table say, art. Ask, remember, and trust. Obviously, we want to continue to remember Tracy and her family. We're going to meet at the funeral home this afternoon, and we'll post those arrangements for you as soon as we know something. But I just need you to know that there are those times when we don't understand it. It doesn't look right. It doesn't feel good. But He's still God. He's still God. We get in the wheelbarrow. We say, okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you. You get us across. Amen. Amen. Be seated.
We hope that you have been ministered to by today's sermon. Our prayer and hope is that you find comfort and encouragement in these words, as well as instruction and correction.